glasses. The glasses has made you forget that you have something as major as inability to see something beyond 6 meters. So what does that tell you? It tells you that although we are myopic, okay, your disability can be completely negated. Your disability can be completely negated and forgotten if you or the society around you decides to enable yourself. Okay? So if you enable yourself, your disability is lost. Right? So in other words, you are determined. This enabling device has allowed you to focus on not what you cannot do, but now focus on what you can do. So that's the principle behind enablement. And that is the magic. That is the magic behind enablement. That allows you to forget about what you cannot do. And let's focus on what you can do. Okay? And that's a very simple apparatus. We don't think of this as a major disabling apparatus. But if you go back 1,000 years, myopics will not be going to school. Myopics will be illiterate. Myopics will not become doctors. Myopics will not become teachers. Myopics will not become scholars. But what happens now? No problem at all. Why? Because we have enabled our myopics with a simple apparatus, nothing complicated. We didn't cure myopia. Did we try to fix myopia? No. We just enabled myopics with something very simple. Okay? In fact, in my country, there are so many myopics. Okay? There are so many myopics and they have no disablement at all that they can even fly F-16s. Why? Because the society has decided to ignore this as a disability and just concentrate on the fact that these are able men who can fly the planes and defend the country. Okay? So that's the principle behind disablement. So that's the first concept that I want to bring in. That enablement allows you to overcome your disability in ways that you may not even imagine. The second concept is that disability is never static. It's a dynamic thing. So you look at me, I look like a normal, able-bodied person, right? But I walk out of this auditorium, I slip on the steps, I fall down, I break my leg, and within a few minutes, I am a disabled person. Okay, so what's the difference? The fact that I was able one moment, and the next moment, I'm disabled. Now, so it is... And you can never protect yourself from disability. As long as human history exists, and in the future of human history, disability will be with us. No matter how advanced our science is, disability will never, never go away. So rather than trying to fix disability, what we need to do is to learn to cope with disability and enable disabled person to lead a normal life. Because that is the only foundational way to solve this problem. Because no matter how advanced it is, there will be diseases. Whether it's orphan diseases, rare diseases, or common diseases, there will always be ailments affecting humans. And there will be never a day where there will be no disabled persons. So if we are going to just try to fix one problem after another, rather than looking at the whole problem and say, let's forget about disability, and let's look at the person's ability, we will never be able to solve it. So the other aspect of this concept is that all of us here, whether we are able-bodied or not, if you think that you are able-bodied, but I just demonstrated to you that many of you are not able, you are disabled in ways that you don't know about, just that we don't know about it. Now, even if you think that you are supremely able, there will come a time when you will become disabled. You will belong to the disabled group. So if that's the case, then disability issue is not a minority issue. It is the interest of the majority, because you will become disabled one day. So therefore, it is in your interest to advocate for your fellow disabled persons because you are one of them. Okay. Now, at this point, I'm going to ask a question. I've just told you that disability is ubiquitous. Some of it is hidden, some of it is overt. I've also told you that disability is dynamic. So one moment you're able, the next moment you're disabled. If that's the case, there must be so many disabled people around us. Right? But if you go to a public place, any public place. Where are the wheelchairs? Where are the people with disability? Why is there an over-representation of able-bodied person in public places? In fact, I think Shilpi wouldn't mind me to quote this story that we shared a few days ago. We had dinner on the first day here, and at the end of dinner, she was telling us about how we are new to New Delhi, so me and a few of us were sitting together, we were saying we should go and check out the nightlife. And Shilpi said, oh, don't worry, I'll recommend a few discos for you. But the moment she said that, the next thing she said was, oh, that's only for you. the disco is only for you. Then I said, why? Oh, because the disco is not meant for persons like me. So I then that made me thinking, if you go to a club, why are there no wheelchairs in a club? Is it because that 16-year-old muscular dystrophy boy does not feel the need to connect with a girl? You think a muscular dystrophy boy, just because his muscle is not working, his other organs are not working, does he not want to meet women? Does he not want to socialize? But why don't we see them there? Likewise, we go to a glitzy mall with lots of escalators and everything like that. You see a lot of very young, beautiful women. But let's say we have a 25-year-old lady with a spastic cerebral palsy. You know, do we see them there? Do you think that she has got any less interest to engage in a very important therapeutic exercise, retail therapy? Does she have any less interest than any other women? But why don't we see them there? So time and again, when I ask this question in my patients, they tell me that they actually relegate and downgrade their life choices. I think many of you will agree with me that many disabled persons relegate and downgrade. So while all of us wanted to go to a disco, we said, no, you go ahead, I'm going home. Now, why? Why are we relegating and downgrading our life choices and lead a lesser life when we have just shown you that you are otherwise completely normal except for one particular abnormality that others may also have? So why do we accept the fact that disabled persons must lead a lesser life? Now, with that I'm going to go to my next concept. Now, many doctors are by training, by nature of their training and their culture, are taught to fix things. You know, everything must be fixed. Okay, something is broken, it must be fixed, right? And so therefore we forget about healing. So the idea is that disabled persons must be fixed. That means they are broken. Okay, like Humpty Dumpty here is broken, and all the king's men and doctors are coming around and trying to fix this Humpty Dumpty because it's completely broken, right? So do you all agree with that? Do you think disabled people are broken? They have a disability, but are they broken? There's nothing wrong in trying to fix it. I'm not saying that we should go around finding cures and, you know, fixing it. There's nothing wrong with that. But when you overemphasize on fixing that particular problem, you're only focusing on what he cannot do. We forgot that what are the other things that this person can do? If there are 10,000 things that the person can do, why focus on the thing that he cannot do? So that's the danger. When you're trying to fix something, you're only thinking about the fact that his eggs are cracked. But he can do many other things. So let's focus on that. And that is the danger of trying to fix things. And the other problem is, if we realize that disability is dynamic, disability is ubiquitous, and disability definition can also change. So if we were to try to fix it, it may not be relevant in another context. For example, so that's why we want some of us propose that we should adopt not a medical model for disability, but a social model. Okay, let me read this out to you. The social model of disability says that disability is determined by the way society is organized rather than the primary deficit of the person. It's how the society is organized. If the society is organized to ignore myopia and allow the myopic person to fly at 16, then that myopia is no longer a disability in my country. Right? So if the society decides that blind persons can do whatever they want, okay, and everything is accessible to them, every TV program has got voiceover and everything, you know, every newspapers are printed in double. And a disabled person, a visually impaired person, will live as normal a life as a person with visual impairment. The difference is not the fact that we have fixed his eyesight, that we have changed the way society is dealing with this person's deficit. Now this is important because society's perspectives, like I just told you, can change. Like many of you are old enough, the audience will know, that in many societies and cultures, left-handedness is a disability. Right? But is it a disability? No. It's the characteristic of the person. Likewise, being an epileptic, you know, in many cultures, even now, is considered a disease of disability rather than a disease that can be treated and cured and managed. Likewise, you know, other illnesses like albino, you know, in places in Africa, albino children are kidnapped because they are thought to represent the witches' reincarnation. And in many societies, I hope I'm not going to offend anyone here, but many societies, being a woman is a disability. In a country not far away from here, I hear that in a court of law, you know, a woman's judge, a witness is half as valuable as a man's witness. The country is not far away from where we are standing. So, if that means even being a woman is a disability in this country. So therefore, you realize that it's not so much the physical impairment, it is how society views the person that determines the severity of the disability. There's no intrinsic value to any disability. So if that's the case, then perhaps rather than just trying to fix the disabled person, we should also fix the perspectives of society. Especially when the perspectives are pathological. I'll give you two good examples. Eugenics. So what the Nazis think? That the Aryan race must be pure. So let's take all broken, defective people and kill them. So this is a mass cemetery made up of all disabled persons. So if some of us were born in the 40s and 50s and we were unfortunate enough to live in Eastern Europe, we would be there. Just because of our disability. Okay? And let me just read some of the things here. A moral and religious conception of life demands the prevention of hereditary ill offsprings. These are the people who are going to go into the gas chamber. And this is a picture of a schizophrenic patient, mentally ill Negro, 16 years in an institution, costing lots of money. Let's just put him in an incinerator, in a gas chamber. That's what it says in Germany. Okay, and these are the buses. You can see that they know what they're doing is wrong. You know why? You see what they have done to the bus windows? They have blanked them up. Because they don't want anyone to see that they are bringing disabled persons into the gas chambers. So they know they are doing wrong. So this is the pathological way that society is dealing with it. So we realize that society can go to these extremes. There are many other extremes that we are tolerating, or many other versions of this that we are tolerating. But this is an extreme. But there are some just under your nose, okay, at the risk of offending people in the audience. If there is a biblical scholar here, please stand up and explain to me how a benevolent God can say things like this. No man who has any defect may come near me. No man who is blind or lame, disfigured or deformed. No man with a crippled foot or hand, or who is a hunchback or a dwarf, who has any eye defect, who has a festering or running sores or damaged testicles can come and offer food for me. That means any myopathy patients, you cannot go into the altar of God because you are crippled, you are lame. That's what it says. This is scripture. Anyone here who is a biblical scholar, please explain to me. How do we tolerate this? This is society's perspective on disability. Okay? Not far from us, we have other perspectives. This is a group of lepers. Okay, before we discovered leprosy is a treatable infectious disease, this was considered atonement for your sin. So somebody has to come in and forgive your sin. Only then can your disability go away. And even in our culture, many of us think that our disabilities are fated. We have done something wrong in our past life, and that's why we have become like that. We blame ourselves for it. These are all pathological treatment of disability by society. And we need to fix that. We need to fix the pathological treatment of disability by society. But not just that. We have possible. Because there is a few things that I want to explain before I go into the next point. Disability is ubiquitous. And we have illustrated there is no absolute quantity or quality to any disability. Okay, that means the person with this amount of disability and the other amount of disability, you cannot compare. There's no quantity or quality to it. Okay, and that is, it's not determined by the physical impairment, it's determined by how the society deals with it. Okay, and disability is often the beholder of the society's eye. In fact, I don't think it's the society's eye, the society's heart. Okay, if the society's heart is big, the disability becomes small. If the society's heart is small, the disability becomes big. So if we are dealing with this kind of problems, then, and disability is never going to go away, it's going to be permanently with us as far as humans exist, then we need another perspective, not just to remove pathological treatment of disability by society, but we need to have a proactive, positive treatment of disability by society. And that, I need to give this example. So if you look at Stephen Hawking, sir, what is his impairment? Total. Because all he can do is move his lip. That right leg moves. So if you focus on what he cannot do, he can go on forever. He He cannot move his eyes, he cannot pass urine properly, he cannot go to the toilet, he cannot stand up, he cannot do this. You can go on forever. But what has society done for him? He lives in an enlightened society. What has society done for him? It deals with not his impairment, but how to empower him, how to enable him. So enable that he is, that he has achieved things that most of us only dream of. And he's continuing to function in his best capacity. So in other words, if we just focus on his disability, he's nowhere. But what we are focusing on is his ability. And change society's perspective. Change society's perspective so that he's able to function the way he can. So some of you may be thinking that's impractical because he's got all this equipment. He's got all this equipment, you know. He's got these computers, he's got this, that, everything. But then let me take a step back and ask yourself. Now, maybe I'll take a step back and give you some background to this. Articles 3 and 1 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights says everyone, doesn't say able-bodied, not able-bodied, everyone has the right to live life of liberty and security, equal in dignity. So that means all of us here must be treated the same way. Okay? Now, many of us, unfortunately, including my country and your country, many of our countries, we live in a country where medicine is considered an industry, right? And medicine is monetized. Medical treatment is monetized. It's not considered socialized medicine. Okay? So in other words, somebody's treatment can be made, leveraged upon to make profit for somebody else. Okay? That's a hard truth of it, right? Most of us, unfortunately, live in that country. But in some countries where they have socialized medicine, when you realize that health, just like any other human right, is not something that you have to buy, it's your privilege. It's a human right. Health is a human right. If it's a human right, then every person in that country, whether it's rich or poor, should be entitled to the same treatment. Correct? So to put the person in ransom and say that if you can't afford this treatment, you die, you suffer, that is immoral. But we tolerate a lot of immorality in our society, right? But that's one of the biggest immorality, the lack of socialized medicine in many of our countries. Correct? Now, if you live in a country where there's no socialized medicine, then any initiative that you take to enable a person has to be monetized. And that would be a problem. Right? So for example, if Stephen Hawking was to live in Singapore, okay, he will have to pay for his own electronic equipment. He has to pay for his special wheelchair. He has to pay for the maintenance. He has to pay for the nurse. He has to pay for everything. Which means that only if he's well off, he will be able to be Stephen Hawking. He cannot be a simpleton and be Stephen Hawking in my country. Because we have a highly conservative fiscal policy where social medicine, any socialized services are left to the individual, extreme right sort of principles that we have. So that means there's no socialized medicine at all. So if most of us, and I think it's the same, I travel quite a bit in Southeast Asia, in Burma, in Vietnam, in Laos, I see a lot of unfortunate events because we don't have socialized medicine. So when we don't have socialized medicine, what's going to happen? It's the well-bodied persons are suffering. Of course, the disabled persons are even going to be more suffering because firstly, they are underemployed. Okay? Firstly, they are underutilized. They are not going to be well off. You don't see many disabled persons who are very well off because they are disadvantaged at every aspect of their life. So how are they going to afford devices and lifestyle changes that are enabling? Unless the country itself becomes illuminated enough to realize that just like defense, okay, just like you spend thousands and thousands of dollars of money on defense, the individual's health has to be guaranteed. A disabled citizen is as much a citizen as his able-bodied citizen. And that is something that we must make sure that we don't compromise on. Okay? So, to paraphrase, okay, ask not what the disabled can do to the society. Let's ask what the country and society can do for the disabled. Okay? Now, this is not something that is grand or anything like that, because society is going to lose. If the disabled are not able to contribute, society is going to lose. So this is a study that I'm quoting from. This is a study in Bangladesh of elderly, visually impaired persons. And they found that there's considerable amount of money that's lost globally, up to 1.7% of the world's gross GDP is lost